And something that really caught people's attention is your work about biology of love. From what I understand, what you propose in biology of love is your reply and your response to what is language and what is humanness.
Yes. Well, when love was present in daily living, when I was a child, the relation with the mother, with the friends, the anger that one sometimes with a friend and stop being a friend of whatever it is. So this play with this notion of love. If you don't love me, or I love you. But what I discover is that language is a manner of living together in coordination of our doings. But for that coordination of our doings, we have to remain together, because I can force the other to do something, yes, with a gun, listening, saying, if you don't do this, I kill you, or with forcing with my hands the person to do something. But if you look at what happens in language, it's a coordination of doings and feelings and emotions, which has to do not by force. You cannot force the other to behave in a certain way in this relation. To play, to do things together. And for that requires an emotion, which is the disposition of being with the other in the respect and legitimacy. We don't usually see love like that. We see love as taken care. Yes, but to take care, you have to respect the other. I want the other to do something, but I want to force, and it doesn't work. So I invite the other person to do something in a way in which the other person feels respected. So I found that for language to arise as a manner of living together, that was conserved from one generation to the next in the learning of children, an emotion was necessary. The acceptance of the other, loving. But the understanding of love as a letting appear came with the work with Ximena. So when I spoke about the origin of language before, I did not really speak about love unless for the space in which it would take place in a family. Yes, the family, but this was obvious. But with the work of Ximena, what she did was to show that we conserve our emotions, our disposition in favor of something or against something. And so it became apparent that the thing is much more fundamental. We do things together either because we want, and this implies letting the other appear in its presence, his or her presence, or we do it forcing the other. And the other does this willingly and hence honestly, and I can trust, and does not do this willingly, and I cannot trust, because the person is going to lie. Pretend that he's doing something that wants to do, but secretly is not wanting to do and will betray you. So in these conversations and reflection, it appears that the secret of love is to let the other appear. If you don't let the other appear, you cannot understand what he or she is doing or talking. You say, what you do, and repeat. But this is a manner of relating in respect. So it appears in this way that love is letting the other appear. But if I want to see how this little animal lives, I have to let it appear, to observe. So letting appear became a very fundamental thing for seeing, for understanding, for doing things together. I, as a scientist, must let the phenomenon that I want to study, the experience that I want to study, I must let it appear. I cannot have a theory. If I have a theory, I will look at what the theory says, and you will observe that much of the situations of scientific expansion of the understanding appear in situations in which one drop out at the theory one had. And to drop the theories is to let appear, because the theory defines what you see. We love to see anything, because you don't let it appear. What you see is your prejudices, your suppositions, your desires, but not that which appears when you don't distort it by those emotions.
And in that train of thought, I think that also a crucial contribution that Jimena does in those distinctions is the presence of our inner sensoriality, from which will it appear.
Because when I met Jimena, she wanted to tell me what she did, and he made the statement that whenever one asks for relational help, what happens is that when you look at it, you find that you have been conserving some pain that you live through some action that somebody did on you, but the community, the society, did not object. So you were denied, but the society accepted this denial of you, and you felt invalidated, believing that this was you, what this denial indicated. And she discovered that if you talk with the person, suddenly she had to realize, oh my goodness. So what I believe that I was not, because I believe it because my mother, my father, my friend, whoever said that I was that. So she showed me first that one conserves pain present in your life. Oh, no, I cannot do that. I am not capable. No, I cannot understand those matters. And then she asked, what do you think that you cannot understand? What did you learn that you did not understand? Huh? And then suddenly the person realizes that it was a belief that he or she had about the devaluation of him or herself that has in cultural history. And so this led us to, in our conversation, to realize that these two things go together, the cultural and the biological. But in this process appeared that love was not an emotion towards that, was an emotion in oneself that let appear whatever was going to happen in front of you without distorting it with an expectation.
And in that sense, and just like Jimena says, it's not that other gives me pain or gives me sadness or gives me love, but it triggers within me.
Yes. And for example, some people says, when one loves a person, I say, I feel so well when I am with you. You make me feel well, but indeed is I feel well when I am with you. She's not making me this bit, but I find that it happens in me when I see this person, I feel happy. That's what I feel. So this changed the manner of looking at emotions. It's not the other that makes me something, but the other triggers in me something that is in me. So he's not responsible from what happens to me, this I, but the other person is an opportunity for me to reflect, perhaps.
And in that sense, it's really interesting how this contribution and expansion that Jimena did in that part of these reflections and work also show us that in order to detach ourselves from pains or ill being that we have conserved, we must step in to an epistemological reflection, just as we talked before, to yes. see where I'm standing and how yes. is it that I'm attached to those things.
Yeah, I suppose one attaches to things because they produce pleasure, but sometimes that same attachment produces pain. So it's a complex thing because we think that behind all this is the problem of reality. We think that there is something there that is real independent of what we do. But if we study our physiology, study perception and all that, we discover that the external thing does not tell us what it is. When Heidegger says, the flower flowers to me, well, but what happens to me with the flower is not dependent on the flower. It's depending on me in my present history. And all that leads you to realize that we live in a way in which what is external to us does not determine what happens in us. Triggers in us something determined in us. So the external is an occasion for happens something in us that is determined in us, but the external does not specify what happens in us. So the matter of cognition must be changed. Now, how come that I do think adequately to the circumstance if the circumstance does not tell me what it is? That is a historical phenomenon. A history of changing together. This is what we talk about when we speak about structural coupling. We transform in our living together, not because we specify what happens in the other, but as we conserve the pleasure of being together, we change in coherence. The moment of what we do begins to be coherent with what the other does, because we have lived together.